Okay, it's 2 minutes past. Again, welcome everyone. For those of you here, welcome to today's panel discussion on engaging high school students via distance learning, or as what some of us call it now, remote learning, looking at the challenges and some of the strategies. This panel discussion will last approximately 45 minutes as we really try to seek to engage you with some information, strategies, and possible solutions that we have picked up from our recent summer school program here at Greenwich High School. I am Garfield Charles, a Manhattanville doctoral candidate in educational leadership. Also the 2020 Greenwich Public Schools Summer School Coordinator, and I'm also an Assistant Dean here at Greenwich High School. In terms of why we organize this panel, first of all, I must introduce our panelists. Kira Mistretta, who is currently one of the assistant deans at the high school, but also a very strong English teacher. Kira really played a significant part in our school's Innovation Lab program, which is really a progressive and very personalized model designed and implemented by a dedicated group of GHS, and when you hear GHS, it really is the acronym for Greenwich High School educators. Next, we have Mary Zara. She is one of our high school's math teacher, and currently a math high school teacher. She also volunteered for one of the new advanced math courses for our students at the summer school program. Next we have Sarah Myers. Currently she's a biology teacher, and she was our summer school biology teacher. She also is a chemistry teacher. In terms of some of the strategies that she really came up with, we really found it innovative. And it really shows in terms of her ability to actually conduct a virtual lab via distance learning. Catherine Bernard, or Kate, she is our special education teacher, and also was one of the special education summer school staff members. And last but not least, we have Dan Silkman, really an up and coming high school social studies teacher who is really passionate about what he does. We were really fortunate to have Dan at our program. So these are your panelists. And some of you guys are wondering, why this discussion now? And why do we need it right now? Well, we saw that, this is important to prepare all educators who are about to embark on this program, for this year, which is somehow filled with really a lot of uncertainties and challenges during the COVID-19 pandemic. And we really hope that this will provide you with sufficient information to assist you in your classes. Before we get into the meat of the discussion, I first want to thank Manhattanville College, especially Heidi, who is really responsible for getting this organized, who's in charge of community outreach at the School of Education. And also in terms of, you know, our district, our superintendent, Dr. Tony Jones. Okay, so to lead off the discussion, we have Karen, who will be really speaking about her perspective, you know, from an English lens.
Hi, Gary. Thanks so much for that introduction. Like Gary said, I'm an assistant dean with him at Greenwich High School, but I have over 10 years experience in an English classroom and designing innovative interdisciplinary curriculum from everything from our Innovation Lab program, which is all project-based learning, to larger big names like Spotify. So teaching traditional content in innovative manners is something I'm really interested in and love doing. So I jumped at the opportunity for this chance to teach full remote learning, which I have never done before, over summer school. And I'm just gonna share a few takeaways with you. The first one is keeping kids in diverse settings present. One thing to keep in mind is that we've always known that our kids have diverse needs, diverse backgrounds. Some schools are gonna have more diversity than others, but we've never asked those kids to turn on a camera and show us what their bedroom or their kitchen table looks like, or if they have a kitchen table. And I found it really important to keep this in mind, not only because it's good pedagogy, but it's something we don't necessarily think of when we start to run a class. What are we going to hear in the background? What are we going to see? Is somebody going to be willing to turn their camera on? So a few tools I found to help keep kids present, even if they won't turn a camera on, not with the bait of extra credit points or the threat of lost points, with nothing will turn their camera on, there are still ways to keep these kids present. One is an extension called Google Meets Attendance, and that extension tracks when a student logs on and when they log off. And at the end of every session, you can download that into a spreadsheet, and you can add each meeting to a new tab or run the spreadsheet. That was really helpful for me when talking to students and parents, because I was able to know if a kid was really with me. Now, another way I was able to keep kids engaged, if they were a little wary of speaking, or if they were a little uncomfortable turning their cameras on, was an extension called Nod, which puts a little hand raise icon or thumbs up icon in the upper left part of the screen. And it's a great way for a quick check for understanding. Everyone with me? We're used to saying that in our classroom, and we can read the expressions and the body language of our students. We might not be able to do that so easily when the kids are looking at us through a camera or they don't have their camera on. Nod lets kids give that quick little thumbs up or wait, hold on, I have a question. So I found that to be very, very helpful. Another thing that was really helpful in keeping kids present in my English class was Edpuzzle, something that I had used in the classroom before, mainly to assign homework or reading. But for summer school, I was using the live platform of it, and what that let me do was, as we listened to essentially a read aloud and answered questions, on my side as the instructor, I could see who answered the questions quickly, who took a long time, and I could see what their answers were in live, real time, without asking a kid to out themselves in front of their peers about their uncertainties or their misunderstandings about text. And I could then gauge understanding, pause our reading, and really clarify or enrich or refine a student's understanding of the text we were reading. So not just Edpuzzle, but that live function where the kids are going through something with you. Again, as an English teacher, we were reading fiction. This could be done with any content that you want to be able to check for understanding and gauge where kids are. Another tool I found very, very useful was one that might be painfully obvious, but easy to miss. In Google Meets, is the chat. I use that as the way to get kids on the same page with me all the time. So I thought of it as like handing out that handout in class, or making sure that everybody had the physical materials. Instead of physical materials, it was the link. Even if we're using Google Classroom, I had all my links ready to go, and I would drop them into the chat when I wanted the students to go to the Edpuzzle Live or the Jamboard or whatever it was we were working on. That allowed students to not have to search or click or find. They could immediately hop to where they needed to be. And I find that immediacy to be something vital when teaching in this context. Think of yourself. It is so easy to get distracted on the internet. And all it takes is moving from one tab to another to get really kind of off course. So not giving them that opportunity was really helpful. On the slide, you'll see a few useful icons, like that Google Meets attendance is the check, nod is the thumbs up. Just so you, if these are things you go look for, those little icons will ensure that you're looking at the thing that I'm discussing. As something in my own personal life I love to do is mountain biking, and I have this saying that slow is smooth and smooth is fast. So if you try to ride smoothly, you're probably gonna go a little slower. But in going slow, you end up going fast. There's, I'm sure, a Zen Cohen along these lines too. I found that I had to cut my expectations for content delivery in half for each class. And I found that it was okay if I ended up with a little extra time at the end, something I never wanted when kids were in desks in front of me or in groups in front of me. Because what that allowed me to do was attend to their social emotional needs as well and make some connections, talk to them. If kids are home, kids aren't with other students, they're with their families, which for many students is lovely. But for, I think, all students, they're desiring that connection with their peers, they're desiring that ability to talk to someone else. And so it's okay to slow down the delivery of content to make sure they're understanding, because it's a heck of a lot harder to check for understanding in this context than it is in a classroom. There are so many little cues that we pick up on, whether we're cognizant of it or not, when we're in the classroom, that just aren't as easy to read through a screen. But if you slow down and take the time, you can certainly know that the kids are with you, that they're learning and they're engaging. It might mean you have a little time left over at the end of class. Make connections with them, talk to them. What are they listening to? Generate class playlists, ask for things that kids are watching, reading. Let them build that community that they'd be getting in passing time or in the cafeteria or before or after school that they're just not getting when they're at home. And then finally, the last bit of advice I have is don't forget about analog work in this digital world. We spend so much time looking at a screen if we're teaching remotely. And screen time was one of our prevalent and always present concerns prior to the COVID pandemic. Those concerns shouldn't go away completely just because we're in remote learning. So think about a few ways to give your kids in class a screen break. There are a million ways to do a Venn diagram on a computer screen, but give kids the opportunity to pick up a pen and use a piece of paper, draw their Venn diagram, have them either share it out or take a picture of it, post it to Google Classroom, post it to a Schoology discussion board, then let kids comment on it. It's a little bit like a digital gallery walk in the end, but give them the opportunity to draw a concept map, to make the T-chart, make the Venn diagram, take the notes, annotate the passage, perhaps, if it's readily available for them to have in hand, and use their cameras on their phone or their Chromebooks, their devices, to post it. But give them those brain breaks. I think that that also helps keep attention and allows for some deeper learning and reminds kids that there's more than just the screen in front of them. So those are my big takeaways, that you have to go a little more slowly than you might think. You have to check for understanding more than you might in a traditional classroom setting. And don't forget that we want them taking screen breaks even though we want them present. Thank you.
Thank you, Kira. And especially for some of the strategies in terms of going slow. And I think that has been a major part of it for many of the teachers. Now we have Mary Zara, who is going to be speaking from math lens, made the way toward one of the middle school advanced program. Her insight is particularly helpful, seeing that some of those students will be moving to the high school this coming year. So I really wanted to get that perspective, as those students were preparing to come to high school, but at the same time, from the teachers end, what were really some of the major challenges that she faced in the classroom. Mary?
Hi, my name is Mary Zara, and—
Are you there, Mary? Yes. I think we are ready.
Yes, can you hear me? Hello?
We can hear you.
So, hi, I'm Mary Zara, one of the high school—
Yep, we can.
—school math teachers.
We hear you.
Okay. As Gary said, this summer I taught an accelerated Algebra 1 course to middle school students, some of which were entering high school or are entering high school this year. I actually taught Algebra 1 at the high school for 15 years, so I was very qualified to teach this class, and I challenged these students using the same rigor, the same material, and I held them accountable to the same expectations. They really had a challenging class. They had 5 weeks to complete all the main topics of Algebra 1 that are required to move on. So the first area that I'd like to talk about is how I handled classroom organization and management. I found it necessary to have 3 screens going simultaneously. On my Chromebook, I presented the notes that we were reviewing for the day, so I could easily keep them on track of which problems we were talking about. And at the same time, I had my Chromebook's camera pointing at my whiteboard so I could write out examples for them. I really liked to have a face-to-face connection with the students, so I also used my own personal computer so I could talk to them like this. So we had face-to-face going on, they could see work going on a whiteboard, and the notes packet was displayed at the same time. And that was extremely helpful for me to keep students focused on what they needed to be focused on. By me having the face-to-face connection with them, it was very easy for me to see and gauge from the students, did they understand or were they challenged? And I would say my biggest challenge was students who remained as icons. And I love hearing the ideas from the other summer school teachers that are presenting them. I didn't have many that were like icons. At times they would like show their camera to give me some feedback. But my biggest challenge was how to get over that. And hearing these techniques from others is phenomenal. They're great ways to do it. With feedback and level of comfort for my students, things I did so I could give good feedback was I created separate Google Meet sessions to hold separate breakout groups within the classroom. And I had multiple Google Meets going at the same time. We communicated in the chat, and it was wonderful. I was able to ask them questions, or microphones were not muted, so I could hear them, but I didn't speak because I had so many sessions open, and I did all my communications through the chat. So I found that a great way to give feedback. They were very comfortable working in small groups, even just listening to the questions they were asking each other. Another technique I use in the classroom is something called fist to five. So a student will hold up a fist if they have no understanding of what we're talking about, or they can hold up a five that says they have a complete level of understanding, or anything in between, just to give me a gauge on where they were. So that was extremely helpful. I feel like having the live Google Meet sessions I had a true connection with my students. We were very comfortable with each other. I also used classroom techniques of cold calling. I would have students answer other students' questions instead of just me doing all the answering. So we had a great level of comfort in the classroom. Everybody was very comfortable sharing. It was as if we were in school, in the building. Technology is what really brings all this together. At the high school, we're Schoology users, but the middle school uses Google Classroom, and I love technology, so I decided to go with Google Classroom. It was so super easy to, I would create assignments, daily assignments. Within the assignments, I had links to my notes packets, links to answer keys for the note packets, links to IXL so they could do math practice. I also used Screencastify on some of my answer keys. So I was kind of there at the same time talking them through some of the problems, and I found that very helpful. Screencastify is great. It's a way to have kids focus on certain areas of the worksheet, and at the same time, you're talking them through what you want them to learn. The other technology I used, which I thought was phenomenal, was Nearpod. From a math teacher perspective, usually I just throw out blank screens, and I have the students complete one of the examples, and I thought it was phenomenal. It was a really true use of Nearpod. On my teacher end, I could watch all my students and see how they were progressing, if they started or not, so I was able to give them feedback as they were working from their homes. And then what we'd do is we'd scroll through different students' work, and we were able to critique it as a group. So I thought that was phenomenal. A big challenge was assessments, because we had to worry about academic dishonesty. So what we did is I monitored the students through Google Meets as they took their assessments. A technique I used is I would have them take their screen and put it a little far away. I'm hoping you can see. Yeah. And I would want to see the entire workspace where their hands were, and I watched them take their tests. I felt confident that there wasn't academic dishonesty going on. And if I did think there was, I spoke to the students. I would ask them, what's that pile of paper next to your test? We're supposed to have a clear workspace. So that is a challenge, but it's something that right now all of us at the high school, we're talking about it collaboratively on how we can get by. Another thing I did with tests, especially math tests, are difficult. I was given all my assessments that I had to give, and some of these tests were very lengthy, about 15 pages, and it wasn't really possible to print every student's test out, mark it up, and then scan it in and send them back. So what I did is I created an answer sheet. So I had a line for every question on the test on one page of paper, and any question they got wrong, I wrote specific feedback and told them how many points they lost per question. So that was a great technique for me. Personally, going forward, I love using Schoology tests and quizzes. And I also think Nearpod is a great way to do some testing, because we can watch the students as they're working. I think it would be a great way for math to do open-ended testing, possibly use Nearpod. Anyhow, I absolutely loved being a remote teacher. I was so pleased that I did have a big takeaway for me was I had a true connection with my students. I told my students, even though I've never met you in the flesh, I feel like I have. We had a great connection. The students were comfortable reaching out to me. At times when the whole class logged off, certain students would stay on in a small group. We'd just talk a little bit more. I also thought all the variety of technology that we have available really can keep the students engaged. And I thought it was really helpful. And in a remote learning environment, I feel like technology is so much more important than in the classroom, because it just really gives us a lot of different opportunities to get creative. And that's about it. I think that the students worked up to their utmost potential. So thank you for this opportunity to share.
Mary, thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Mary. Sorry about that. I was going to cut you off, but that was good timing. Now we move on to Laura, who will speak from the science lens.
Hi, everyone. My name is Sarah Myers.
I think we might be having some difficulties here with Sarah. So in the meantime, we can move to...
Gary, what's up with Sarah?
It's Sarah.
Yeah, we can see and hear her, Gary.
Gary, I think it might be your computer that's lagging. We're okay on this end.
Hi. Okay.
So I'm Sarah Myers. I teach...
Oh, sorry about that.
No worries. Biology and chemistry okay. here at the school. I taught biology over summer school. And one of my favorite successes from the experience was really being able to create engaging, innovative, and timeless content. So being forced into a new situation gave me the opportunity to step back and look at lessons from a different angle, because lessons are created with a teacher in mind, being in that classroom facilitating, and it's a little bit different when you're remote. So how can I reshape lessons in a way that makes sense for the digital environment, really took me out of my comfort zone in a way that made me try things that I never would have tried if we were always in class. So I had students doing scavenger hunts to get away from their screen. I had students doing escape rooms to kind of jigsaw their way through biology problems in order to get out of the class on Friday afternoon. They had to, you know, break that lock. So just really creating things that I never would have otherwise. But the other key for me is really making that content timeless, that we are not throwing together lessons last minute to make it through a pandemic. We are creating timeless content that is valuable for students to allow them to engage with the material over and over and over again. So if you think of your traditional in-class lecture or assignment or task, students get to engage with you once. You have a 15-minute mini lecture at the start or end of your lesson, and students get to hear you once and get to ask you questions once. I personally use VoiceThread to record, but others have mentioned Screencastify. There's lots of video recording options. But I would record things on VoiceThread that allows a student to engage when they are home, if they zoned out for a few minutes, if they need to see it again with an assignment, they can look at it as many times as they want. And that really keeps, if we're talking about engagement, just the sheer number of times it is available to them is an opportunity. It also, when they came back to me and asked questions, it wasn't like, remember that lesson the other day? I need you to start from the top. It allowed them to really pinpoint what their question was and where they needed to go back to, because they were able to rewind the video if they just missed what I said. So a big takeaway for me was really creating stuff that I thought was cool and different, but also timeless and usable and engaging for the students. The next kind of takeaway, and I think Kara did an awesome job kind of discussing the engagement without seeing their face. So I'm going to kind of take this bullet in a slightly different direction. Initially, I was thinking, you know, just because you can't see a face doesn't mean you can't gauge level of understanding or gauge how engaged they are. You just have to think of creative ways to do it. That also applies to group work. So I would argue that it's actually easier to monitor multiple groups and multiple assignments at one time when the teacher is sitting in one place in front of all their groups. You're not running from this corner to that corner to address the 20 students that might be yelling your name. And something I found very, very valuable are group roles. So earlier in my teaching career, you know, I had group roles, but we kind of had the director of this. And the, I found that you really need to streamline it. Each assignment had to come with very explicit group roles. So there was always a student who was the facilitator, and they were responsible for flagging me on the Google Meet chat when they had the group had a question. So there, again, there aren't 24 people yelling into the Google mic, but there's only six groups at a time. And the thought of managing six students and their group questions compared to 24 is a lot different. So again, just sort of thinking out of that box, making things a little bit more intentional and structured up front. And then the last thing, again, is are those non-screen activities. Because I teach a lab science, it's really, and there's such a hands-on component to a lab science, how do you really take that on a screen or off a screen? So I toyed with both. I did labs on my desk in front so they can kind of see, they directed me as we went. So I played with that, but also being able to play with virtual labs that I hadn't in the past, which was interesting. So a lot of times we hand out a lab, students might do a little inquiry about designing a procedure, but we know that safety is also a concern. We can't give them free range. Well, in a virtual lab, you're able to say, here, go, click, play, see what data you need, see what numbers make sense. One of our NGSS standards is really pushing them to figure out what data is important and what data is miscellaneous, and being able to do it in this virtual setting where the safety is not a concern, and me maybe doing a demo and them doing it virtually was another really great way for them to practice those skills of figuring out what they needed during lab time. So those are kind of my big takeaways. So that be creative, be innovative, you know, try something you haven't, think out of the box. Oftentimes that comes with collaboration with peers. My peers are awesome. I'm really excited this year to kind of see what everybody else has in mind, and make it timeless, stuff that you're going to use and that the students can use over and over again.
Thank you, Sarah. I see that, you know, time is really drawing on us, but we definitely will have all our panel members present. Next, we have Kate, who will speak from the special education lens. Kate?
So hi, I'm Kate Brainerd. I'm in my 20th year as a special education teacher and my second year here at Greenwich High School. I've always taught high school. Once I started, I couldn't stop. And I just want to preface this by saying that one of the challenges that I face while teaching students with special needs is that as a special educator, my role became blurred as I spent much of my time reteaching content when we first went into remote learning in March. So I realized I learned trial by fire what works and what doesn't necessarily work pretty quickly. So in a sense, during that time in the spring, I was wearing two hats. So what is exactly special education? I think a lot of people don't really know. Special ed is specially designed instruction intended to help individuals with a disability access the curriculum. That's our job. So what are some of those obstacles to access? So they really fall into three categories. They can be physical, cognitive, or emotional. So examples of physical challenges could be the ability to hear, see, or move. Cognitive challenges could include decoding, processing, organizing, retaining, recalling information, receptive and expressive language, and that's just to name a few. It's pretty complex, actually, how we work cognitively. And then finally, emotional challenges that can be a source of the disability, like depression or anxiety, or they can be a byproduct to support self-concept, overcoming the fear of taking intellectual risks, or just simply feeling misunderstood or judged. So when I looked at some of the challenges that my students and by extension I faced during distance learning, they included assignments from regular ed teachers and general ed teachers that provide, you know, assigned readings that couldn't be converted from text to speech, which if I had a student with a significant decoding problem, difficulty, I would have to read all of the content to them and work through it with them. Essays and papers that had to be posted in multiple places for credit. So if I had a student with executive functioning, they might post it in, you know, Google Docs, but then not do it and turn it in, or vice versa. So a lot of students were losing credit because they were unable to follow multiple steps to submit an assignment. PowerPoint presentations that were too long. For example, I had one PowerPoint that I had to work through a student that was 78 slides long, which again, if you have difficulty with processing, decoding, if you have attention deficit disorder, it was just way too much information. It was just incredibly challenging. And then finally, in terms of like emotional access, if a teacher had office hours, if the student was really struggling, sometimes they didn't feel comfortable going to the teacher and saying, I don't understand, or I need help. Now, that's certainly not the case across the board. I definitely had teachers and students who would make their office hours, who would work together, but frequently or often, I would have to reteach the content myself, or I would have to meet with the teacher to fully understand what exactly they were looking for in a class. I basically was on Google Meets from 8 in the morning every day until 4 or 5 in the afternoon. So if the student can't access the curriculum, if all those pieces of access are missing, they don't learn, as a lack of access prevents understanding from connecting, generalizing, and understanding. So basically, the assignment becomes meaningless. So how do we design instruction to ensure that our students with disabilities are learning? Okay, so this summer, I taught a group of middle school students with IEPs. And some of the strategies that I used included emailing the student every morning with the link to the Google Meet for the day. Now, I had one email, it was already pre-set up. I would just have to send. Every now and then, I would tweak it a little bit, like, yay, it's Friday. But then I would post the link of their IXL math practice for the day that would be right in the stream, and then post a Google form to ask a leading question to prompt them for the reading that day in Google Classroom. So we read two novels over the summer. One was The Giver by Lois Lowry, and one was Number of the Stars. So an example of when teaching The Giver, my goal was for the students to understand the author's message for the reading that day. So I started with a Google form entrance slip, which was easily accessible on their Google Classroom stream, and asked, if you could choose a job that you would do for the rest of your life, what would it be? The purpose of this activity was to prime the students for the class discussion by asking them to reflect on something that was meaningful to them, and something of which most of them had a very strong opinion about. Probably the most frequent opinion was, I don't know. But in turn, it supported engagement. The kids got energized. They, you know, talked about each other's choices. It was it just in general supported engagement. So how did my strategies connect to access? For starters, I read the question out loud. So if decoding was an issue, that's like off the table. That's not to say that I didn't teach decoding skills. That was a separate thing, which I used Lexia. I worked with kids a lot on Lexia in terms of decoding skills. But in that particular assignment, I read the question out loud. I encouraged them. I told them not to worry about spelling, that they can write as much or as little as they like, as a way of like helping them to develop their writing skills and to feel comfortable taking risks. I'm not gonna judge you, so just write as much or as little as you want. I gave them the opportunity, sorry.
Not to cut you off, but I know you have so much more that you would like to share with the group, but I also know that we have limited time, and I wanna see if we could have Dan, just so if you wanna leave with just one you know, poignant point that you wanna share with us before.
I think if I was going to summarize, I would just say that the assignments have to be accessible, easily accessible, simple, and straightforward, and to keep it meaningful, and that works for students with special needs. So thank you.
Thank you, Kate. So now we can move to Dan, who is speaking from the social studies lens. Dan.
Great, thanks, Gary. Hi, everybody. I'm Dan Silkman, high school social studies teacher who led a class this past summer remotely for civics class, for credit recovery for juniors and seniors. Just wanted to walk through a couple of challenges that I experienced in ways that I'm going to hopefully apply what I learned this summer to some of the things that are happening virtually this year in our hybrid model at Greenwich High School. And so I'm a new teacher. I just rounded out my first year in the classroom. And so I was really anxious about pulling together lessons, not only that would work for my classroom, but also for this new digital learning environment as well. But the best piece of advice that I got that really proved successful for me was that I should build my lessons with the same structure that I would as if I were in person, but just apply some new tools like Google Meet or Schoology in a different way. And so I applied the same sort of approach or methodology to lesson planning this summer in that I had a warm-up activity with my students when they first came on. We had direct instruction and small group discussion. And then students had independent practice like they would in the classroom where they broke into groups or did an independent task where they could, you know, sort of stretch and shut off their camera if they needed to in order to apply what we had discussed in that large group setting. And then we came back at the end to have a closure activity again, like we would to sort of confirm understanding of the students and answering questions that they might have had before giving sort of the transition or alluding to what we would talk about the next day. And so that I felt was super important to not just get bogged down in all these new tools and applications that are part of our new digital world, but to think back and get back to basics on the template that worked in the classroom that also worked well for me in the virtual environment. And then the other piece that I know Kiara talked about and all the other folks is that, you know, the focus on the social emotional learning of students is critical to our experience in a virtual environment because we can't see each other and we can't engage in the same way. And so I noticed this as well with my students over the summer. And one of the things that I found really, really great in my very small class, I will admit, was that I was able to set up daily checkpoints for 15 or 20 minutes with my students after our, you know, sort of traditional lesson had closed out during my office hours. And so I met one-on-one with the students over Google Meet. We talked about the lesson of the day. I answered specific questions that they had about the content. But more importantly, I was able to learn about the things that they loved and were interested in. We were able to apply some of the concepts around politics and government to things happening in our town or in the state of Connecticut, answering questions about why did the federal government respond to this crisis in this way? Or I saw this in the paper, what do you think? That I found really important for relationship building, even though, as Mary said, we never met in the flesh. And so what I'm taking away from this experience in the summer is that I need to establish a system or a mechanism this fall as well to make sure that I can maintain those connections. And so I know Google Calendar has an appointments feature built in to all of their events where I can establish, say, for 30 minutes on Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday that students can proactively and independently log on to my Google Calendar appointments and determine for them when 15 minutes might be good for them to touch base and sync up on what we've been doing in class and maintain those one-to-one connections. So I'm hoping that I can build on what went well for the summer to enhance my instruction this fall. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Dan. And I know we have utilized the full 45 minutes and we haven't even reached the discussion part where we were really hoping to have our panel members actually, you know, piggyback off each other, but at the same time, really discuss, you know, further some of the questions that we have. So I just want to just draw on you guys a couple of minutes, probably just 3 to 4 minutes as we end, speak about one of the central questions that we have overall. And I think all the speakers have been speaking about engagement here. How do we engage our students via distance learning? But one of the major components of that is, you know, and it really relates to that main question that I posed at the very bottom there, you know, how has, you know, the summer experience, you know, teaching distance learning really changed your perspective of the teacher's role in the classroom? And I see that as really crucial, you know, moving forward into this year where many of you guys have been speaking about that sort of, you know, looking outside of the box, reinventing, you know, your role. So if we can, you know, do this probably in 3 minutes, it would be great. How do you approach that?
Gary, I think that for me, one thing, it's not necessarily that it changes my perspective. It reinforces my belief that a teacher is a facilitator of learning, not a person who delivers content. And it has to be kind of forefront in the teacher's mind that we are teaching deeper thinking skills, that we're teaching analysis, sort of piggybacking off of Dan's connections to the community. It's connections to each other, connections to teachers, and connections to our content that are meaningful. And without that, it just doesn't work.
So you highlight a very important point there, Kira, in terms of, you know, that deeper thinking, also in terms of more meaningful. And I think we are all harping on, you know, this concept of personalized learning, you know, where there is that, you know, connection with our students. Anyone else want to jump in with that last question that we have there?
I would agree that it's not a change in role. Our jobs as teachers have never been different. What we're being asked to do now is just think about it in a different way. And I think the differences in our students are so much more apparent, whether they are home or they're here, or what I think Kara was talking about it before. You know, are there babies crying in the background as the student is trying to do work? So I think if nothing else, it has shed more light on how important it is for us to really be mindful of the backgrounds of each individual student. And we talk about it all the time. We talk about diversity awareness and differentiation. But now more than ever, I think it's staring all of us in the face as we're getting an literal look into the worlds of all of our students as they're in and out of our classroom. So it's just enhanced that even more. And it's helpful for me to have that at the forefront of my mind. You know, when I'm teaching during the year, I primarily teach our honors level students, and it is so easy to get caught up in, I have to get them to the final, I have to get them to the midterm, I have to teach them the importance of cellular respiration, when actually now you're able to take a step back and you focus on the differences, the social emotional learning, those connections. And really, if they don't know what cellular respiration is in 3 years, it's okay.
Thanks, Sarah. So you really emphasize, you know, the social emotional, or what we consider as, you know, one of the key areas, you know, especially for our district, we are really focusing on that social emotional learning, you know, as we move forward into this new era of, you know, COVID-19. So anyone
I'm happy to talk about question 3 and 4.
I think we only have time to, it's already 4:50. So Mary, if you want to
really quickly.
Yeah.
Sure. With how do you balance classwork, homework, and the hybrid remote model? I think it's very important to keep assignments very manageable. What our expectations, as one of our other panelists said that earlier. I think it needs to be very manageable, and just give them the most important things to work on independently as homework. Because the learning is just different when they're at home. They don't get the reassurance. Even though we're going to have them on the Google Meets, they're still not with us. And I think with 4, managing the students working, needing help at the same time on different assignments, as one of the panelists said earlier too, I think the setting up separate Google Meets breakout rooms is really effective with that, and using the chat feature to address students' questions is a great tool.
Thank you. And thank you, each of the panelists. Thank you for actually volunteering your time to share your knowledge and really share your experience about, you know, what we see as very crucial moving forward, you know, preparing for a different time period in terms of, you know, how do we connect with our students. And from you know, all the panelists, you know, what we hear coming out is that deeper connection, you know, that social emotional piece, you know, that ability for us to moving forward to really, really think outside of the box so that we can really enhance and engage our students' learning. You know, it's changing, but, you know, some of it we have been doing before, but as we move forward, we really have to think more about, you know, some of these key areas. So again, I definitely want to thank everyone for registering for this panel discussion. You will have a copy of the event will be sent to you in your email. So feel free to get a copy of our meeting. Thank you again. And any questions that you have, please direct that question to any one of your panelists. Some of you I see are from the high school, so we will definitely be willing to give you more information accordingly. So thank you all.